My name is Marjolein Herings and I work as a junior researcher at the Ratana Institute. My colleague Stans would join me, but unfortunately she's ill, so you have to put up with me for the next 15 minutes. I guess my presentation shows the wide variety of e-infrastructures for technology assessments, because I think this is a very different type of methodology than our previous speaker. We used an online narrative tool for doing technology assessment. So what we did, we designed a website where we collected stories of people who had experience with the hospital, because we wanted to assess how people experienced the hospital, and I will get back to why we wanted to do that. And when I was looking at making this presentation, I noticed that the poster that we made actually has a hand writing down the story instead of an online tool. So I think this also shows that in our project also the narrative was very important. So just to give you some kind of context of our project, we wanted to look at the hospital because we think it's a complex socio-technical system, and we also wanted to create new methodology to look at stakeholders' perspectives of complex socio-technical systems. So this is also something that we wanted to develop in this project. And also the hospital was sort of a ground for debate in policy making and also in society. Actually around three different themes. One is a policy aim of the Ministry of More Transparency, so measuring and ranking quality of hospital care to foster regulated competition in healthcare. And linked to that is also reducing cost of healthcare. The idea is that once you have some kind of ranking of where the best quality of care is, then you can do some kind of reducing of practice variation, and you can also centralize certain care practices to hospitals that give the best quality of care. And another big discussion was around patient-centered care and patient empowerment. So the organization of care should be patient-centered along this policy theme, and the patient should be more empowered to be an actor in governing quality of care. And there was actually at this time of the project, there was also some new laws discussed in Parliament about patients' rights that give them a more active role in governing quality of care. For instance, by giving them a more active role in guideline developments, and also giving the client councils at hospital a more active role in various more aspects. And the third theme linked up to this is also to empower patients to participate more in their own diagnosis and treatment, and this actually fostered sort of more left-wing parties to emphasize that patients are not capable of having this sort of empowered role, and right-wing parties, to say it a little bit black and white, to emphasize that patients should be more empowered and should take up a more active role in their own diagnosis and treatment. What I forgot to say actually with the first slide is that this transparency measuring was also very quantitatively done. So this is much about performance indicators and quantitative ways of measuring and ranking quality of care in hospitals. And so we wanted to just actually gain insight into how this patient perspective could learn us more about quality of care. And also instigate discussion about how the patient perspective could have gained a more of a role in sort of this assessing of quality of care and this ranking of the hospitals. And also we wanted to instigate sort of this more policy and public discussion about this new role of the patient. So is this empowered patient, does he exist, what does he need to be empowered? What I said as well, we wanted to develop this sort of this narrative methodology. So we asked ourselves, how do patients and their loved ones experience hospital care? And what do they tell us about, these experiences tell us about the role of patients in hospital care? And how can they contribute to quality of hospital care, these experiences? And so we used a narrative methodology, so we had patients donate their stories to our website. And why this narrative methodology? Because we think it gives us some kind of access to the consistency and logic of an experience. This is what stories do. And they learn us how patients give meaning to the event of being in the hospital, and it gives more contextual and situated information. So instead of just patients, for instance, ticking a box on a scale of 1 to 10, how they like their nurse, a story can give us some kind of insight in how they experience the contact with this nurse, for instance. So we used the website to collect the patients' narratives with hospital care, and I will mostly focus on that aspect. We did storyline analysis and thematic analysis, I won't go into that now. We also organized workshops with healthcare professionals, and there they read some of the stories and we discussed some of our analysis with them. And also we had interviews with a various range of stakeholders also to discuss our preliminary conclusions. So we used this online narrative tool, and we tried to design it in such a way to enhance the narrative aspects of the stories. And we did that by giving it the format of a letter. So we asked the patients to write a letter about their experience, and they could give a heading to the letter, and also send it to someone. And in that sense, we wanted to enhance sort of the narrative aspects. So not that they would give us just, you know, like you would do on a website, for instance, on TripAdvisor, give us some kind of comments like, I really liked my stay, and help us, excellent, but we really wanted to write them to write a story about it. And also we gave them some open and closed questions to reflect on their story, like for instance, what they thought were the major themes of the story, who they thought were the major actors in the story, and all these kinds of ways to assess, have them assess their own story. Of course, we also asked some background questions to help us assess the stories, for instance, how often they had been in the hospital, how long was their stay, what kind of illness did they were in for. And we, in the design of the website, it was also very important for us to come to some kind of meaningful, informed consent with them giving the story to us. And so this is something we really thought of, how can we design this? And we decided to ask for consent after they wrote their story, because we thought then they could only assess best what they wanted with this story, because maybe at the beginning they didn't know how the story would turn out to be. And we gave them the option to share the story only with the researchers, or to also share the story with the website, so other people could also read their stories and reflect on them, or not to share the story, and then it would not have been visible to us as researchers. And also, we wanted to design the website in such a way that we would foster the privacy of the people who would send the stories to us, but also the people who were in the stories. And this is how we designed the website, in such a way that the stories would just enter at the backside of the website first, and then one of the researchers would read the story and see if it was anonymous or not, and then only then post the story on the website. And I think this helped well in sort of protecting the privacy of the people in the story and also sending the story, but it was also sometimes a little bit frustrating for the people who shared their story with them, because they didn't see it immediately on the website after they submitted it to us. So we had about 10,000 unique visitors in the course of 1 year, and there were 100 stories shared with us. And I think one of the major lessons, at least for me also, with this kind of online way of doing technology assessment, was that once you have the website, your work just starts. Because it took much more effort than I thought to really attract visitors to the website. And I think this is sometimes a little bit of a lesson, that you think, well, if you do something online, it's easy, you reach a lot of people, but there goes a lot of work into reaching a lot of people. And so some of the things that we did was, we designed a banner, and we posted it on many different medical websites, We placed ads in local and national newspaper that also asks for some resources. We designed a flyer which we send out. We contacted all the Dutch hospitals to ask if we could put our flyer there, and about a quarter agreed. We also targeted different patients for us. So we put ads up on about 100 different patients for us. And so I think there was quite a lot of work really went into just making the website visible and making it known. So in the end we collected 100 stories, and we really, when we started up, and maybe this is a little bit naive, but we expected a lot more. So, but what was good about it, I think, is that we reached quite a diverse audience in terms of where people lived. So we got people from all over the nation, mostly people who were admitted in the hospital, over 30 different specializations, covering over 50 different illnesses, so also very wide variety. And also for me, what I really liked about it is that there were positive experiences and also negative experiences, and they were about the same. So a lot of people sort of were skeptical about that we would only gain very negative experiences, but that really wasn't the case. Actually, most of the people found their experience to have both positive and negative aspects. We did get a lot of women visiting our sites, and mostly higher educated people, almost all native Dutch people. And I think this might have something to do with also the online tool, but it definitely also has something to do with the assignments, because, you know, writing a story might create quite a barrier for people with maybe lower education or non-native Dutch people to do something like that. I don't know. So just to reflect a little bit on what we've learned from using this online tool to do our project, it really costs a lot of time and a lot of resources just to attract people to your website. So that's, I think, my main lesson. As you can see on the website, there was a lot of texts also as well, and I think next time we could have also made more of an effort to make it more engaging and more fun to share your story. I think this was already very sort of maybe a little bit boring in a sense. The website was the visual aspect of the website. I think we did access a lot of people, and so it also helped us a little bit in sort of making our institution known to more people. And we also accessed people all over the country, but mostly higher educated and native Dutch people. And I think what is a great sort of lack of the way we put up the website is also that we had very limited stakeholder involvement. Of course, that was also part of how we set up the project, but the interaction of the different perspectives of the different stakeholders in the hospital really had to come from us bringing the perspective of the patients to the other stakeholders, instead of sort of organizing an interaction more directly on the website, involving doctors to reflect on the patients' stories maybe on the website, or involving different kinds of actors. So that also needs a different design. And we had some space where people could reflect on each other's stories, but there's not so much interaction going on there. It's just very limited. I just want to go over the conclusion of our project just really fast, because that's not really the main message of my presentation here, but I didn't want to leave you blind over our conclusions. So we made a report, and our main statement was basically that empowerment is problematic in the hospital. Patients need to speak up just to look after themselves and look after the fact that to get good care. They need to speak up to improve healthcare. We saw many aspects in the stories where something would go wrong if the patient hadn't said something about not getting the right medication or not getting the right kind of treatment. Or so the active role of patients was really needed to improve the quality of care. But we also have a lot of stories where patients who did speak up were then also sometimes a little bit put down or felt that they somehow problematized the relationship between themselves and the healthcare professional when they did. And so we think that the patient voice is very useful for improvement of healthcare in the hospital, but it isn't always heard as well as it could be. And so we sort of summarize that in four themes that problematize empowerment. One of them is that patients, when they enter the hospital, they are facing some kind of problematic life phase, and this preoccupies also their attention. Second, what I already said, that this active patient is not always appreciated in the hospital. We think that really is a missed chance for the hospital for quality improvements. And third, we think sometimes the patient is also disempowered by the hospital because they feel that they cannot speak up because of they are inside this system. And there's a lot of expectations about what should be done, or and they are not always made explicit. So we made sure we came on the front page of the Metro the day before there was a big discussion in Parliament on hospital care. And so two members of Parliament mentioned our report in this debate, and the Ministry of Health gave an official reaction to our report, which for us is an achievement because the Ministry is not forced to react on us. And we had a lot of media attention and also a lot of attention on Twitter, which you talked more about. So thank you also on behalf of my colleagues.
Thank you very much, Marisa. Just a moment, make a suggestion for the discussion. I think you have presented some very in-depth insight also in the last slides about the content of your topic, but in this session we wanted to discuss the e-infrastructure aspect, so
yeah.
If you want, I would suggest to rather focus on this aspect, on how helpful this kind of methodology is, etc., etc. Please, go ahead.
Yeah, well, maybe I have a kind of mixed question, because it's about infrastructure, but also about content of what you're doing. Because, I mean, it's very interesting in you're trying to engage patients and trying to bring this topic back to the hospital. Well, besides the reasons that you mentioned in engaging patients or including the patient voice, a very important reason why including patients is not happening is because usually professionals do not see patient voices or coordinated methods like this as scientifically valid, or
yeah.
Just an individual case, or doesn't apply to them. And you told that you had workshops, so you try to make a circle around.
Yeah.
That's one thing you expressed. You try to take what you had from the website and bring it back to the professionals. Could you maybe say a bit more about that part of your infrastructure, what happened in the workshops? How did professionals react?
Yeah. Actually, I want to make a small sidestep, because in the report also we described about 11 different ways of implementing sort of the qualitative voice inside the hospital. And I think that aspect was also talked a lot about in media and really helped sort of to make that, to bridge that gap that you just talk about. We did one workshop with young doctors and one workshop with elder doctors and one with nurses. But surprisingly, the young doctors were much more closed to this idea that this patient, qualitative patient voice could have like a place, a meaningful place in the hospital and in assessing quality of care. And the older doctors, they were much more easy to come up with examples of of how it had helped their improvements. But we could talk about this maybe also after the session.
Lars?
Can you tell a little about it? Let's say that you had chosen another method. You had made workshops template different places in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
You had made some sort of more representative sample than you got here.
Yeah.
And you count the hours you used on that compared to the hours you needed to use on this to make it work. Yep. Can you make some sort of comparison of the efficiency of the?
I think the advantage of this is that because of all this work we did to try to reach people, this also meant that sort of the name of our institute got known to a wider variety of people. But I think on just looking at the content of the, well, that's one asset. I think in the next asset is that, well, we collected 100 stories. It's not a lot, but it's more than sort of doing 20, seeing 20 people in different focus groups. And I think this number also has some kind of impact, which is, you know, a strange statement for me to make, trying to advocate for qualitative research to say that this quantitative number has some impact.
But the
content, and the content, to compare the workload to the content, to be quite honest, I don't think we would have different or less results if we would have done the focus groups maybe with different stakeholders. I think.
And you would have same kind of workload.
Yes, because
what you say?
Yes, because I think so much of the workload really went into making up the website, setting up the website, interacting with the people who make the website, and then getting the website under attention. And that's, I think, is really something to keep in mind, because often you think, oh, we do it online, we just put some website out there and it's easy, it saves a lot of work, but really it doesn't. There's just a lot of different work.
Just very briefly, the reason I ask is that Pat Hamlin in the US made a comparison of a face-to-face and a mixed and an only online consensus conference, and he came up with the result that all of them could be made, but the online took more work than the face-to-face.
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised.
So there is something else we should go for. That's a little sub-conclusion. With the online, there should be something extra.
If I may add, I also think that you could control more of the parameters that are important for your work.
Yeah.
Because if you just send out a message, just tell us your stories, you don't know who is answering at the end, and you obviously had a very strange sample in the end, very distorted.
Yeah.
One, whereas if you do interviews or focus group, you invite people explicitly for it.
Sure.
So this is also another aspect of it.
And I think it also has to do with how long-term you plan your project, because we only actively ask people to come to our websites for this 1 year, but then maybe if you set up the infrastructure for a longer time and you collect more and more different stories, and then you can, for instance, look at different diseases, or you can target maybe different audiences to sort of mix your sample in a better way, and then maybe all the effort you put into the beginning and making your website known will actually pay off in the longer run, but that's maybe a helpful thought.
You're optimistic.
Yeah.
Okay, that the topic of this session is on e-infrastructure.
Yes.
One might ask if what you are presenting has many application cases, or what are the typical application settings where this method might be useful, so that it could be a type of an element of an infrastructure, not just one case study.
Yeah, I think, well, that's a very much question to ask me. So this is also what we wanted to look at. So we have this hospital, which is this complex system, and we wanted to see how a stakeholder would experience it. And we wanted to do that by looking at stories of experiences. And so this way of collecting stories through this website could be a means of looking at other kinds of different systems, and also looking at other different kinds of stakeholders. And there's, for instance, there is a company in the Netherlands that has evolved this kind of method, also to look into user perspectives of different kind of surroundings or technologies, just to use it as a different kind of sort of also evaluation technique, so to say. And I think if you want to do that, then, and what they also did, is that you have to try to think of many different ways in which the people who write the stories themselves can also assess and analyze the stories, because we also spent a lot of time in analyzing the stories, and then you also create new ways of biasing and And what they did is also create some kind of structures where they had to the people assess their own stories and do their own analysis.
I'm Henry from Post UK. My question is, do you feel the written letter format was a good choice?
I would really have to sort of make a research project to see how it would compare to other ways of getting narratives. It worked in the sense that we really got stories, and we got stories of 16 pages, and we got stories of one page, but they were all, well, mostly they were all really stories. So in that sense it worked, but I don't know if it would have worked better or less than another structure.
I missed why you actually chose an online solution.
Yeah.
I would like you to elaborate on that, why you opted for that method. And then you mentioned that there were several tools to attract people's attention to the website. Are you able to tell which one worked best?
Yeah, we did some kind of Google Analytics, and actually the online, well, it's really hard to really say exactly, but my sort of my hunch is that the patients for worked best, because we saw a lot of people just clicking on the link and then from these four and then going on. So, but that also creates some kind of a bias, because that's the patients who are already active online talking about their illness experiences. So we also wanted to have the other tools to attract people who are not sort of active patients in that sense.
Just as you said this, I came to a new question. Would it be feasible to look in, let's say, social networks if there are this part, if there exists this type of debate that people are sharing, maybe for specific diseases or illnesses, but that there are already exchange of ideas, what they say, what they found worse or.
Yeah, well, it's actually.
This would be based with.
Yeah, in the Netherlands, there's also this website which is called Care Map, and in this map, people can rate care institutions and care providers, and also write a short comment on it. But it really gets the form of this TripAdvisor, like, I don't like this doctor, he's not very nice, and it doesn't give you it doesn't really give you insight in why does this patient have this experience with this doctor? And so there are some ways in which people exchange sort of their ideas of the quality of healthcare, but we really wanted to have a narrative structure.
Okay.